Hello everybody, I'm Arden, welcome to another episode of Minecraft Enigmatica 2 Expert. Last episode, I said we would continue on with Mekanism and work on an ethylene burning generator to provide power. And today, let's do exactly that and pick up where we left off. And the next one up is the Electrolytic Seperator, which it's the means for creating gases in this pack, which is used for some of the machines and or duplication, but it's also used to make the ethylene for the next one. And to make this is also really simple. Even the electrolytic core is just pulverized metals. All right, and now have that made as well. If we put this on the ground and take a look at it, you can see that it takes a fuel source and then breaks it into one or more materials. You know what? I got my machines mixed up completely. We do need this to make the ethylene, but it's not the first step. We actually need another machine to process this, but this breaks water into hydrogen and oxygen. It also breaks down a couple other things into different pieces that we will need for later. And now that we have the machine that can actually make hydrogen and oxygen, we need to be able to turn that into ethylene, and we need a machine that's not actually in the quest book to do that. We need the pressurized reaction chamber, which isn't really all that hard. This is all just basic materials to make. And what this does is it will allow you to combine water and hydrogen into ethylene. We'll also create substrate as a byproduct, which is used in making HDPE pellets, which is all used to make plastic. All right, and the pressurized reaction chamber is done as well. If we go into it, you can see the interface is pretty close to the same as the electrolytic separator, but in this case, it takes two fuels and outputs a single one, as well as the substrate in this case. But it's not quite time to hook this up yet. What we're gonna do next is go make the next thing in the quest, which is the gas burning generator, which is one of the things that can burn the ethylene. And other than needing tough alloy, which thankfully we're getting out of our mob farm, it's not too hard to make. All right, and now we have the gas burning generator as well. And this lets you burn the gaseous ethylene just straight up in this. And we could just end this right here and set this all up and make this go. But you know, why do that when we can instead fall down a massive, complicated rabbit hole that I've never actually done before? And that's delve into the realm of advanced generators and set up a massive Endernium gas turbine to generate a whole lot of power. When we mouse over the gas turbine and hold shift, it shows the various fuels we can use in this, where ethylene is one of the better options, but not the only one. There's actually other things we could use here, including refined fuel. But we might as well just use the ethylene because that's where we started with this. It shows you the modules that you can use in this. It's a big multi-block structure. The important ones are the turbines, which you can use up to 50 of them, a power emitter module, which in this case is the flux generator here, which outputs RF power, a fuel air mixer to increase efficiency, and a gas mix compressor to do greater efficiency on top of that. We can add fuel tanks to add internal capacity for the ethylene, as well as power capacitors to basically give it a large internal battery. The other things basically just give you control options to pass redstone in and out of it. So to give you an idea of the rabbit hole we've fallen down, if we take a look in here, if you've watched all my other stuff, you might only recognize the redstone iron wiring, which we've used elsewhere, which isn't that hard to make as long as we have the basic coils, which are kind of a pain to make, but we can mass produce them pretty easily. The most complicated thing here is the control circuit, which as you dive down, is just a whole bunch of parts we've made recently, but then you run into things like the printed engineering circuit, which requires us actually set up the A2 Inscriber. Thankfully, we have all of the engineering press plates, so all we have to do is actually make the Inscriber, and the Inscriber is pretty easy, other than a Fluix block. And you make a Fluix box by, well, pure Fluix crystals. And the way you make the Fluix crystals is you toss charged Sirtis quartz crystals, nether quartz, and redstone into water. To give you an idea of how the pure nether quartz crystals work, you just start by making the seed, which is just ground up nether quartz and some sand, and then you just huck them into water and wait. And you have to be pretty patient, this can take a bit. And Fluix crystals are similar, except they're charged Sirtis quartz crystals, redstone, and nether quartz. And you just huck these in as well, except these actually produce a lot quicker. As you can see, I got them immediately. And you can do them in large batches. And now I have more than I need for a while. and these, however, are going to be a bit. I'll have to check back on these much later. Alright, so the Inscriber is pretty easy to make. I'm just going to put it on the wall behind me. And the way the Inscriber works, it requires an Inscriber press to make. There's four of these. They're found in meteors out in the world, although you can actually manufacture them in this version, although it requires you being into mystical agriculture to do so. But they aren't all that hard to find. So the one we need is the Inscriber engineering press, which goes on the top, and some diamonds, which go in here. And then it slowly starts cooking through them. And out comes the printed engineering circuit, of which we need four. And with these complete, we can now continue back down into the rabbit hole of all the stuff we need to make. The most expensive of which will be the Endernium turbines, which aren't that hard to make. They just require a bunch of Endernium. They require 11 per turbine to make, which thankfully we've got a fairly large stock of platinum set up now to work with. I mean, not a humongous, but we've got enough to kick out a bunch of turbines. I'm gonna have to play this by ear to see how much fuel consumption we actually have with this before I actually get forward, moving forward on this, to figure out how to scale this up properly. But I figured we might as well start with the actual top tier turbine instead of, I don't know, the many lumen or one of the lower ones. So let me go make some of the basic pieces. This is gonna be a bit, because this is one of the first things I've made where it starts tying together all of the other technology packs that we've been having to work with. Okay, so I got tired of waiting for the pure nether quartz crystals. They take hours without help from AE2. So I went a bit deeper in AE2 than I had originally intended. So what I did was I made an energy acceptor to draw power from my main power grid off of this power line into my empower and turn it into AE2 power. And that is now getting pumped into this crystal growth chamber, which if I pop these all in here, this was ours and it only up to 12%. If we put this in here, you see that it immediately starts climbing and will finish very, very quickly. So it's not the full AE2 setup. There's no controller in here, but it does let me get my crystals much, much quicker. So we can move on. I'm almost done with the pieces, I swear. All right, so I've got this set up at a very, very basic level just to get an understanding of how all of this works. Over here, we have my crushing factory that I moved in here. It's currently crushing up the trees that I put in here before and turning that into biofuel, which it is then piping down the wall down into the PRC. Next to it is the electrolytic separator, which is taking water from the top, is dumping the oxygen because I don't need it, and creating hydrogen and putting it into the PRC, which then has the hydrogen here, combining with water, creating substrate, and creating the gaseous ethylene. We're gonna have to dump the substrate out pretty soon so that this stops being a problem. But the ethylene then comes over into the rotary condensator to turn it from gaseous ethylene into liquid ethylene, which then pumps over into my advanced generator. Over here, we have the gas mix compressor and the fuel air mixer, which increases the efficiency. We have the general controller right here. We have the fluid intake valve. There is a gas intake valve, but it doesn't appear to, even though it says that it works for this generator, doesn't appear to actually do anything for this generator. The flux generator, which is creating the RF that is feeding back into this system. The high density power capacitor, which is the big battery. The fuel tank to store excess liquid ethylene, just so we have some extra capacity in case something goes wrong. And then a single Endernium turbine. If we come in here into the controls, you can see that the ethylene is being made faster than it's being consumed, and the battery is at a surplus, so we are producing significantly more than we are using. It apparently is creating 1600 a tick, which is not shabby at all, and is just filling up the battery very, very rapidly. So what I think I need to do now is add turbines, figure out what the breakpoint is, pump the power out of this, and also put an input into the crusher from the outside. I'm probably gonna use the oak saplings because I have thousands of them in my storage. It's completely capped out right now, and we'll have to see if it's got enough coming in from my tree farm, which is very prolific, to keep up with this. Otherwise, we might have to put some cloches in here or something to produce like the standard watermelons everybody else actually uses. We also need to add upgrades to some of these machines because they run pretty slow right now, but we are producing faster than we're consuming currently. So let me scale this up some. Okay, so I've upgraded it and I've moved it back here, back with my other power stuff. It's up on the wall, so it has easy access to a slave above it, as well as a very, very large energy cube that I just decided to use one of my resonant upgrades that I've had lying around to do. So we will have an extremely large battery to fill up here. As you can see, it's already in progress and it's filling up pretty quickly. Coming back up inside here, you can see that I added a box for the saplings as well as an output pipe into a tunnel for the energy cube. Coming back over to the machine here, I added 5 more turbines just to get an idea what the power creation is like, as well as the resource draw. So right now with 6 of them, it's now creating 9600 RF and only using less than 1 millibucket per tick currently. If we look inside the condensator, you can see that the liquid ethylene is more or less holding steady. It's not really gaining, but it's not really using it up either. I currently don't have upgrades in all of these machines yet, and I'm going to go do that next and maybe add a couple more turbines to see where we stand. But so far, it seems to be working like a champ. That said, we'll see if it hits my saplings, and until we fill up that energy cube, we're not gonna know. So we'll see how much we have left after that happens, but I have thousands to go through, so I'm not too worried about it. It's just if it can keep up long-term. All right, I upgraded all of the machines and added 16 more turbines, bringing it up to a total of 22. Looking at the rotary condensator, it looks like we are creating enough to meet demand inside the turbine itself, so that's good. And inside the turbine, it's now creating 35,000 a tick, which is pretty good for the amount of effort that went into this. It used up a lot of material, sure, but this actually wasn't that hard to put together in the scheme of things. It still hasn't caught up to the battery, and even when it does, it still has to charge up the 25 million in its own, but it's going at an extremely fast clip now. So we should hopefully find out if it's maxing out my saplings or not once this stabilizes. Looking back outside, the energy cell is now a little more than 3/5 of the way full, so that's good. And looking at my supply of oak saplings, it has devastated it, but there's still a lot left in here. So we'll see if once it stabilizes, if the rate of use goes down significantly, and it should, because the battery should buffer it enough that it shouldn't be on full draw all the time. It should have a fairly large amount to pull from. So if we look inside the gas turbine control, we can see that it's generating 35,200 with 22 of these in place. This means it's generating 1,600 a tick for this. If we scale this up to the full 50, it will be generating 80,000 a tick, which probably makes it worth doing off of a relatively low draw on the ethylene itself. So far, this is well within our means. Oh, and we just maxed out the battery, and this is now full and stable. And I can plug this into our actual network now and see if my tree supply stabilizes. So that's actually good to know. Yep, and now it looks like the general passive draw of my base is stable enough just to the oak saplings constantly tick back up. So I think we're in the clear for now, because this will probably max out, and then when we do have spike draws, it'll have a full box here to draw from, as well as what's in there currently, as well as all of the biofuel that's cached inside the crusher factory itself, which is one of the reasons I'm using the crushers, just to keep a larger backlog inside of it. So I think we're in an extremely good spot now for power. So I'm going to call it good here. And as always, I'm Ard. Thank you for watching, and have a good day.